Underbart. Okej, klockan har slagit 5 och det är nu hög tid för mig att få presentera nästa talare. This speaker is, I'm really, really happy and proud to introduce Ricardo Flores. This is actually a collaboration that we make together with the lokalföreningen här i Skåne. And so we are very happy that we could bring you here today. And yeah, the stage is yours.
Thank you very much. Thank you for the invitation, Angelica, and everyone for coming. I was thinking what to explain today in relation to the theme, the general theme that is the repair of the day, and I was thinking that what I could do is to explain how we call the lecture the right to inherit, because how we take care of the things we inherit as buildings and how we bring them forward into the new program, but not only the care of the physical condition of the building, but also the emotional, all the invisible contents that the building has and has arrived to us, and how you embrace that inheritance and use it for the new program instead of erasing, adding them. So the new program is based on that and what you inherit, and then builds on that. So this is something we also worked on, presented in the last Venice Biennale last year, because it was also about how would you work with what we inherit, or we presented like that, and the decarbonization. And so we talked about reusing everything what is already built. And the Biennale, in the spaces of the Biennale, what happened is that we wanted to fill in mostly the atmosphere of our office, on how we work. Oops, it's coming very fast. Eh? Did you get it? Or I go again? Okay, I go again, sorry. You have to be faster. Okay, let's start again. So this is the space. The space is at La Biennale. For us was like bringing our studio there, and our more like considering the Biennale space like a laboratory where you really bring into the tables. The tables in the Biennale were given by the curators, but not nothing else. So we thought in filling in all the section, all the space that was given to us with the different material that surrounds us in the everyday, and help you to move on in the everyday of the projects, because you constantly are struggling and coming and going with the doubts and the problems and the failures and the crisis. Everything is part of the project, and we thought that it was the best way to share and our work in a Biennale was to bring the questions that the project opens, the answers, but more the problems, and to have a conversation with the visitors in that way. So we took the section that was given to us and filled all the space, all until the mezzanine, which is 7 meters, which was quite hard, because then we thought in these big images that are normally around you in your office and surrounding you when you work and are past works or inspiring or things that are on the construction or have been stopped or etc. But you always have your drawings around you helping you, and that you have the books and you have the models and everything. So the place where like getting into a studio of someone which is working, is struggling, was thinking on things, on reusing things, and then different projects that were kind of representing different themes that the reuse, adaptive reuse theme opens. So the work of the office was not clearly one project clearly visible. It was process material on top of the tables, hanging from this kind of tripods things inside of containers, hanging also some models that were from past projects that were not present, but always are around you as well, helping you to think and to move on. Some projections, like a big pop-up, a projection of the Sala Beckett project on a big pop-up theater that we built on purpose for the space. And then the tables became that thing, drawing on top of drawing. It was the really what you have on your table. and this sensation of that the tables are not able to hold everything that you think, that your head is getting more and more and paper is falling down, and in a way you have all this material accumulating, and in the middle of the process is very enjoyable, but at the same time is you have all this transparency and seeing things under others. All the models were original material, were processed material from the different projects. And one of the themes, or we divided the area in five themes to help people navigate, that were in a way guided by different, these themes were guided by the experience of working, like drawing with time, all these drawings that you make accumulating all the time of the different, of the building, the different moments that have passed through, the open condition of the ruin. One of the open condition of ruin was trying to think in this moment when you enter to a building that is given to you. This is, for example, in a competition. So when you visit the building in a competition, is there abandoned? And the ruin is waiting for you for your interpretation. Is not showing you a specific time. All the times are accumulated. It's like a palimpsest of what have happened there. And then it's for you to think in which moment in the evolution of the building you locate yourselves to start working, in how far you go back to start moving on again. In a way, it's thinking how in which direction I'm going to take it. So the ruin is there open for you to look at it, to value it, and to take it into the next step. This is the project of a cultural laboratory in Brussels. We are now about to start construction. It was a former theater, a theater of varieties, in the middle of Brussels, in the old town, for many, many years, from 1920s on. And now it has been abandoned from the 80s. So it's in a very, very bad condition, but the spaces are really beautiful. They are amazing. When you enter there, also it's in a very compact part of the city, and you discover that spaces that are 15 meters of height, and then the flight tower of the former theater, which is almost 30 meters, is something really astonishing. It's a treasure that you find in the middle of the city, where you cannot see that. So this is it. No, so we have it gives to two streets, one narrower, more like a backstage, one more important, where it's a main facade, which is listed because it was done by a very good architect, Belgian architect. Bourgeois in the 30s, and but the rest is not listed, which is something really weird, because they tell you you can save the facade, but the rest you can demolish. This is something for us is very difficult to understand, because the whole thing makes sense in the place, in the giving to the two streets, all this brick architecture which is in the site, the compact condition of the building. Everything is the building. It's not just a listed part. No, when heritage selects a part to protect and the rest no, is really difficult to understand. So, but then this was a competition, and as part of the competition they were asking, this is for an association which works with social work and helps ex-prisoners, the people from drugs, etc. But for getting all these foundings, they organize a concert and a music and theater event once a year that became very famous in Brussels. It's called Festival de la Liberté. And then they ask for to the city of Brussels a place for organizing these things in a more regular way, in not being moving from place to place in town. So they found this space, they found the competition and the work for them. And this is where we started into the story. A part of the program was not only two spaces for music and for theater, but a space called Forum, which was a space that they understood like a place for meeting, for gathering, where you could get in and not paying ticket and being, you know, knowing the activities, etc. So when we arrived to the place and we got under the seats and we go into this space, which was so amazing, we thought, okay, if the Forum is already there, if we are able to save it in the competition with the two big halls, a big hall for 1,000 people, another one for 400 people, etc., then we have it already there. So all the competition project is how to fit these two spaces in a way to save all that as a common area. So what we had is the big hall is like the sky of the, it disappears as the roof of the building. The petite salle, the little hall, is under the already a bar that they already had, so it's like a topography. So you say part of the seats, And then you're in another place, which is a bar under the big sal, and it's already there. No, so it is a bit the proposal that wins the competition, and then everything else, like this bar, where they can also make music, they can make events in the former stage, they can make things open air, and the two sal. So they have five spaces to make events simultaneously. So that's the proposal that now went on and is going to construction soon. Technically, it's very complex, as you understand, because has a lot of people doing things at the same time, and then the building has to accept all these activities and fire escapes and so on. But what is interesting is this thing: you can cross. The competition proposes between the two streets, the backstage and this one with the two. So you can cross, you can go and see what's going on. You can go to the bar and you can leave without entering to the activities. Everything that is for free, and then becomes like a topographic public space, because you can be here, you can be sitting, you can be in the bar, you can come back, etc. All that is something that you enter, so it's like you are giving back that thing to the city of Brussels. No, the Brussels city gives you a building, and then all this is like a gift that you return to the citizens in Brussels. And nobody need to enter to the events if they don't want. So this axonometric shows that. So this is the cut between inside like an internal street, and then for the internal street to be a street, you need natural light. So the former skylight becomes flight tower becomes a skylight that brings all the way light to this space. The former stage stays there, and then you connect the light from the street with the light from the top. So all that has the space has the aura of a public space, and can be really a public space like a square. So you connect this facade, which is the one protected, with this one, which is not listed but is much more interesting because it's much more unfinished, much more contaminated. It's really wonderful, and you can see the windows, the Bierendel wind. So the kind of architecture is the same architect, but this one is like the non wanted, and it really is much more interesting for us. But you see in the competition drawings, you can see already the interest in where you will be entering, how people will be entering to the space and moving through, and also entering in the back part of the scene if necessary, depends in the spectacles. And all that part will be more like the part for climbing up, going into the bar, looking into the street, going down again, so you can be sitting there, spending some time. But then that part is related to the facade, which we extended for the big sal. This is interesting because in the moment of defining the materiality of the project, then you have this problem of thinking what is going to be in which material. But you have the flight tower, all the stage, which is brick and will bring the brick towards the front. You have the white kind of facade, modern facade, bringing in its white condition. And then you have the big sal and the stage on the stairs and the bar that could be concrete. So that drawing, it's a drawing that we have done because this project we do it together with a local office, a Belgium office called Ouest. And so to exchange, it's interesting because this drawing is only to exchange and to tell them, look, we think that the material should be very minimum and the minimum possible and very clear where it starts. Otherwise, it will be too complicated because the spaces are already too complex and to understand. So there are some documents that you produce for exchanging with your own partners in this case, and then to have this discussion and, you know, convince them or not of your position, and they make others and so on. So you see the model, you have all this space, which is the former Cache de Seine, which is we open to study the different sites. So the drawing on top of the existing is very important, constantly to understand and to think how are you going to treat the different facades or the different textures. So the Cache de Seine opens up in this big drawings, always based in AutoCAD drawings, but the hand drawing is constantly again back and again. No. So see, here you have all this part in the brick, this part with the concrete, and this part with the white coming from the facade. So the study of colors is something that you constantly, using the big drawings on the tables is very important, because then you can see the whole thing and compare with other possibilities, etc. So they are around us for a long while, and then we exchange, and then we continue to thinking for months while we go with other things. So the model, fragmentary model, is very important as well, because then you can use it for studying the different parts, like the big hall that is for amplified music has to have 1,000 people dancing or with someone singing. So it has to be very prepared for acoustic, for climate, etc. But you always have this public space under. You see, this public space is connecting the light of the flight tower with the light of the street. So so this space is also possible to make some actions, because there's a bar here, so you can have some music in a low tone here. So, but then you have all the lightnings, all the acoustic, etc. over there. So the model helps you a lot. For us, it's very helpful to physically see all the installations. You know, you see all the air conditioning, all the water pipes, etc. All the fire, etc. It's very important to fit it in the model. So here under this bar, we have the petite salle, which is a salle that you enter here. It's for theater, dance, a lecture, something more contained. But also, is in an area where you have all the pipes, because it's underground. No? So you have, if you build all the installations that your advisor sends you in a beam model, then you bring it into the physical model, there's a lot of mistakes. And they don't believe it, of course, at the beginning, but then you show the model with a canvas, see, this is crossing a double space, you're crossing, they look somewhere else, no? But then, even if you find one mistake, is enough for you to make the model, to control. Of course, you comb it very well, very carefully. You make it go through the spaces in a more ordered way than what you say sent you, and then you send all the drawings back, and then they redraw the installation project, and so on. So the model is very helpful to make understand also how are going to be equipped the spaces for the people to enjoy. For example, the big sal that has all these installations around for renovation of air, which is very heavy because there's a lot of people at the same time, but also have the fire escapes. You see, you have the spaces for enjoying, and all the rest, which is invisible, for us it's important that it's not visible, all the pipes and everything else is not visible, so that you feel the emotion, but you don't see the effort that the building is making to make you go and enjoy. So all that you can really fit it very well. It's like if it was a luggage, no? Like when you make your luggage, that everything fits inside other things. You see, everything is very ordered in the courtyards and so on. So this model is present in the office, and it's also helpful for studying the drawings of the engineers and your advisors. It's very important for us. But this material, like that, with the legs, etc., was exactly like that in the Biennale, with an open open situation, so that everyone can enjoy and see and discuss and tell you things and opinions. No, another table that was with another subject was called the value of use, how you reuse things you inherit, was represented here by the Sala Beckett project in Barcelona, especially for the big work of reusing all the elements that we found in the building when we arrived. All the doors, the windows, the roses, the lamps, the stairs, everything that was there was reused. Not only for economical reason, but also for historical reason, for emotional reasons, and also for recycling, because it was staying in the same place and being we loved everything that we saw there, so we thought everything has to stay there and be part of the new Sala Beckett. So this is a cooperative building, a workers' club that was abandoned. Also, the cooperative bankrupt in the 70s, so the building was left there, and then the Sala Beckett, there was already a theater group, they needed a new home, so the municipality organizes this competition to host them there. The problem is that when from the moment it's abandoned until the moment of the competition, many spaces were really destroyed or bad used, like the ground floor, for example, have become this sauna club with all blocking all the windows, putting mirrors, making a big sauna pool, all the pavement, beautiful pavements, all the iron cast pillars were dismantled, mezzanines, etc., etc. So the spaces were really, really lost. All these spaces for activities that we don't know, we don't want to know also what happened there. But was they were really destroying, erasing the memory, you know. So they were. It was a time here that was negative. It was not adding, but it was really covering or negating the past. But the upstairs, the remains of the theater of the cooperative was still there, and then you could see the sky, and then you could see, of course, the raining and the pigeons and everything. But it was really moving because you could see that the building was still there, like waiting for you to recuperate it. And even if it was in such a bad state and the building was not listed, so you could really demolish it. We thought that it was so full of stories and the lives of the people who have used it was so present, and the neighbors that were around were still sons or grandsons of the cooperativists that were using the building. That for us was obvious that we wanted to keep it. And so in the but there was the beginning of the competition because you had to decide, yes, this state of the building, which is in ruin, will be able to host contemporary theater, which means acoustically perfect, or no, even climate, etc., silence from room to room, and so on. So it's a challenge that you move on almost unconsciously because you think, yes, this building has to remain. But then how you make it remain or not is the technical difficulties is up to you. No, you need the help to do it. So this is the when we start to see all these elements that we are still there. Half of the building was destroyed, but there were a lot of doors and windows and things that we thought, okay, let's draw them very careful so that we can learn of the building culture of the place and this and the area that we're done. Then we make this inventory with all the numbers of the different plans in the model so that we can have them when we work, and then we can use it for working for the future project. But at least we have all that in the same scale, like an inventory in your office, in front of you, and then you see what are the elements what you can count with. So with that, you start to say, well, this one has glass, so it can be in a corridor giving glass through. You can have more important ones. You can have the more humble ones. It was very, very interesting to see how you could place them in different places because of the character of each of them. I have this video that I like to show because it's very clear. That's the dynamic of moving things from one place to the other. So this is the first floor, as we inherited, and this is the project first floor. So you know there are some things like the facade that they remain in place. They change the color, but they remain where they are. Some things in the first floor that they remain in the first floor, but they locate differently because the new theater activity makes you move things, like the staircase in the bar comes into the school area, and you know some things of the former dressing room goes in the new dressing room. Some things stay there, but depending on the qualities and in the conditions, you really make them move in one way or another. Some things change color, some things they adapt in size as well, but we still had all this thing that we didn't use. So we said, okay, in the ground floor, that was such a disaster, was nothing there to recuperate. Let's bring things downstairs, like in the former cafe, we bring them to the new former cafe, which is also downstairs, to the new cafe, which is leading with the vestibule. Some things of the bath of former toilets of the actors go to the new dressing rooms of the actors and all that. Some things in the school of the kids, it was a school for the kids of the workers. They had these beautiful plafonds there that we could use it now for the administration part to host, to archive things behind and so on. So when they were landing, and when some things had to modify because they were too small for the area where they were arriving, and they were sometimes get the color of the new part, so they were being adapted but never left the building in a way. It's like if you threw things in the air and then they fall down in a different place, but they are still in the building. The same happened with the tiles and with everything that we found there. But it was a very interesting moment, many, many months, where you were really thinking, how should I use this, how should I do that? They were changing place. As soon as you would move more and drawing, you would move the things. Ah, that door, that was so beautiful, let's put it here. No, there is better, etc. You had all these things in your head. But you see, they are very interesting because they are all different. They have been done, who knows if the carpenter was changing mood every weekend or what happened. But they look the same, but they are all different. So some of them, they look the same, but they are not. So they are telling you, I'm more proud, I'm more humble, I'm more whatever, I want to be in the vestibule, I want to go to the toilets, etc. No? So they're looking at them and in a way taking, being with love with the things, you would really be able to think where to go. The same with the tiles. At the beginning you have to break one or two or three, but then you start to take them from the bottom and they come. We had done an inventory, of course, of all the different drawings of the different rooms of the building, which tiles we had to be able to, you know, they go to storage in pallets while they were reinforcing the building, but they would come back. So you were reinforcing the building structurally, acoustically, because there were moments where the upstairs theater had a coincidence with the downstairs theater. You had the two theaters. This is the new one and this is the existing one, but the acoustic had to be perfect among them. So the upstairs theater would stay with all the walls as we found them, but the pavement is different because it's timber. So when you had timber, you could reuse the tiles somewhere else. So this is the existing site, as we inherited with the former theater, the former cafe, the former school of the kids. And now you had a theater with timber, rehearsal room with timber, some timber here as well. So you could really move the tiles to make you come welcome from here. These tiles of the cafe moved into the offices and vestibule. And these ones of the former theater would go, of course, downstairs to make all the connection between the bar and the vestibule. So you could really work with that to make the new project happen and then make it all continue. So when you enter, you know that everything is vestibule. The bar and the vestibule is all for the public to move. So this is a bit the reuse of the things, but the main problem was how to connect the different parts of the cooperative. You had different departments. You had the former grocery store of the cooperative, the leisure part, and the school of the kids. So the central, the vestibule, is where you connect all that. It's in this center where everything happens. You see, before they were disconnected, and now you had to make it work like one drama center. So the vestibule becomes crucial, and connecting the circulation with the light makes you understand that you are in a space that is all is the same, all is a school, all is a place for learning. So at the beginning, this floor slab, which was in such a bad state, we take it out to make the new connection with some holes, not to see through. But then in this moment, it's very interesting because you see the building falling down, because you find it in a ruin and you ruin it even more, because at the beginning you break it more and you don't know if the building will stay with you or will fall apart or what happens, but then it stays there. It's very, very beautiful, it's very moving. And then you have all the doors stored, the tiles, everything is stored, and then you want to do this connection, no? The connection, when you enter, you see up, you see the skylight, you see, and then you hear some music of people studying, and you understand you are in a school. So this long, long wall that connects upstairs and also with the bar through is very important, because this wall before was just a division between rooms, but now it's connecting you up, and behind is bringing you all the way behind until the theater's classes. You cross it with the bar and with the eyes, and again physically and the light. You cross it many times. It's a wall that has a lot of responsibility in a way, and it's here already appearing in that with the light moving you, making you look up. But also you see the pedestrian, the pavement is helping you. It has a reflection, so it's telling you that is going, what's going on in the sky of the space is the same as the floor. So these big holes are again a bit like looking up at what happened when we arrived. No, we had this light from the sky and open up. So we thought to bring this ray of light again inside was an important thing of the memory of the place. And so you arrive there, and then you are here. You have the light from here coming from the other side of the wall, bringing all the light in, but you don't see the source of the light. You see where it's that you see some light, but you don't see where it comes from. You see this half a moon over there, and then you understand as you climb up, you understand a bit more. So it's inflating this dome. The dome is what makes evident the entrance of light, and then when you arrive here, and then you're in the center of the. But you see how it comes down to welcome you, to bring you up. All the traces of the building, of course, are there to remind you, to make you think what have happened there before. And then, so this is a bit the comparison of what we found and what happens now. So you have have all the public part here. All the actors are here in that part, come here on the administration, and the technicians come this way. So there are three different entries. So the public doesn't know that behind there is all these people preparing for the play, and this is the entrance to the main downstairs theater room. No, so here you arrive, you make the queue, you pick up your tickets, you wait in the sofa, or you you queue for the downstairs theater, or you go upstairs where you have all the classes, and maybe you have a theater upstairs tonight. So there are these two situations where you go in, but the vestibule crosses it all. So you see upstairs you have the different former theater, cafe and classes. Now you have a theater as well, but then you have rehearsal room and classes of theater of different. But you can understand how the effort is here in the center. Before, you see everything was like making you move out. Here everything is concentrating in the center, you see, and making you share with the students, the public, the professors, everything share there. So this is what happened, what you can see in this video. You see the actor enters in this door, and you as a public enter in this door and the vestibule. You pick up your tickets here in the box office that you might have bought in advance. And then you go to the bar to wait, maybe for your friends. Or in the sofa as well. In the meantime, the actor, very shy, he doesn't want to see the public in advance. He goes to the dressing room or to the changing room and starts to, you know, repeat and again the play. So he's really struggling, and so you are having fun in this side of the wall, and everyone is and someone is panicking the other side of the wall, but you don't know. It's not your fault. I mean, so, and then you can. You can go upstairs if the green room is for the younger companies that act in the upstairs theater. It's more experimental. So if you have a play there, you queue here while you can cross students or other people of the theater, which is very interesting because there's a lot of interaction. So with this staircase that we built, now the actor stays here until he has to enter. And then you have the other part, the technician, of course, which is very important, and he goes straight away to the control cabin because then he has to take care of the light, the sound, and so on. You see the way of sittings and scene is changing constantly. It's very experimental space, has a lot of possibilities. Every director who comes changes the configuration. But then after the play, you can really see the actor. Now he is really happy, he is relaxed, and he goes to the vestibule, and then he meets you and the friends, and then you can go there. And if you are not too shy, you say hello, how much I liked it, congratulations, and he, you know, tries to say no, it was not so good, but you know, yeah, no, it was fantastic, and so on. So, and then everyone, also the technicians, everyone mix, and everyone is in the balcony to smoke and to see the street. So, yeah, that's the end of the day, you know. So you see, they have the main facade. You arrive and you have the bar. The facade is really in a very derelict condition, as we found it. You only have the sign of the theater, and you have Mr. Beckett over there, so you understand that there's a place, and then you go through. Everything is very transparent. The bar is very transparent, and then you go into the vestibule. So the tables become the tiles, becomes the tickets, that becomes the sofa, that becomes the light, the ruin, the marble staircase to bring the light down. And then the community is there. You see, you find everything is filled by the community of theater now, which mixes with the community of the workers whose remains are still on the walls and around. So this is interesting for us because it was making a community with time, with people who we didn't know, we didn't see, but they were there, previous generations from whom we inherited the place. And that is something that is mixing different times, and is something that we haven't done before. So you have all these spaces with the light, giving you all this condition of public space, making it, you know, democratic in a way. Everything can come through. It's not a space that in a way overwhelms you, but is welcoming you and is saying, as we found that ray of light in the former stage, this ray of light stayed there, and it's almost open air, almost in a very fragile condition of the ruin we find, but there's a new activity there. Thank you.
Magic.
Okay.
Thank you so much, Ricardo. It was an amazing. I think he's worth another one. I thought. Yeah. Just love your work, and we're very happy to have you here. Thank you so much.